Michael. Yes, you're right. I'm involved in the melanoma field for decades, and it was really a very frustrating time. So I summarized that we have treated more than 3,000 patients in clinical trial without any benefit. So it's hard to understand why we didn't give up. And suddenly, starting like 2010, it's a big disadvantage if the hazard ratio or the improvement of a treatment is below 30%. And many or most of our trials really show benefits, and sometimes the benefit is incredibly strong. And why is this? I think the main reason is that melanoma was the field where all the information about basic research unified, and this progress in research is reflected directly and translated directly in the treatment of really a very bad disease. And I would say melanoma is really one of the most aggressive cancer types. Certainly brain tumors are awful diseases too. But sometimes melanoma patients experience a very dramatic disease. So one of the things that I learned here in Zurich was to understand the origin of melanocytes. And actually, these are really very interesting cells because they are derived from the neural crest. And they have many relationships with other cells, for example, with cells of the adrenal glands, with neurons. And they have also a very interesting history during development because they migrate. And one of our research programs is to understand the processes of migration during development. For example, in fishes, in the zebrafish, and Mitch Levesque is sitting up there. He brought the expertise in zebrafish biology to us, and in zebrafish you can nicely study the migration of the melanocytes, and we think that these programs that are used during this migration are also programs that are important during the process of forming metastasis. And the other very interesting concept is about the molecular biology of melanoma. So if you look at the melanocyte in the skin, this is a very tiny, slim cell with a lot of dendrites, staying in contact with many other cells, and is also controlled by other cells like the keratinocytes. And if you see here schematical a melanocyte, and if you look at a melanoma tumor, actually by morphology, you can hardly distinguish this from any type of other malignancy. And we have a very clear sight on the molecular mechanisms that are involved and on the spectrum of mutations. And I like this paper very much by Michael Krauthammer. Actually, he is from Zurich. He's working now at Yale. I like this paper very much because he claims that melanoma is a erythropoietic disease. So more or less in every melanoma, we see the signature of an activated MAP kinase pathway. And this is illustrated by this graph here. You see here many different melanoma samples, and then a number of mutations. And look here you have the first or most frequent mutation in melanoma, which is an activating mutation of BRAF. If the tumor does not have an activating BRAF mutation. In many tumors, you can find an activating mutation of RAS, typically NRAS. And then if both of them are negative, you find here an alteration of a tumor suppressor, neurofibromatosis gene 1, MNF1. And this gene is also involved in the regulation of the MAP kinase pathway. It's a suppressor of the pathway. So actually, all the cases till here are directly explained by a driving pathway, the MAP kinase pathway. And we think that we can probably later on also explain the other cases. And one other important information, and this is the nice about the clinics. In the clinics, we are forced to learn about everything and to integrate everything and translate it into clinical relevance. So if you see here this graph here, This gives you the mutation rates or the mutations per sample, and you notice that.
I don't see what you point.
Oh, you don't see what we're pointing. That's interesting because on my screen it's working, so I move, yeah? Okay. Thank you. This does also not work. Habt ihr noch einen Pointer?
Ich muss anstellen.
Ja.
Auf der Seite.
On. Yeah, it should work. Sorry. No, it's okay. So just, it's nice on my screen, but not on the projection. So BRAF mutations, RAS mutations, and here the NF1. And the mutational load is shown here on this part. And you notice that the NF1 mutations are associated with the highest rate of mutation, and you know melanoma is on the skin, out on the outer skin, so the major cause of mutations is UV light, and these mutations are typically caused by UV, and this is also logically associated with advanced age. So the molecular biology of melanoma is really very logical, and this molecular biology has direct implications in the treatment. Because, and I will discuss this later on, we have medications that affect MAP kinase pathway signaling, BRAF inhibitors, MEK inhibitors, and we have immunotherapy. And one of the important predictors of the response to immunotherapy is the presence of neoantigens, and neoantigens are typically caused by mutations. So the success story of melanoma sometimes is simple, and one of the reasons why melanoma is really developed so rapidly is that melanoma cells can be cultured routinely. We do this also in our lab, and if you culture a lot of tumor cells from your patients, you can predict some outcome. Actually, this was tried for chemotherapy without success, but this Nature paper 2006 here is a very simple paper. It shows you melanoma cell lines without mutations in BRAF and RAS. It shows you NRAS mutated melanoma cell lines and BRAF mutations, and you see here the impact of a MEK inhibitor, so a drug that interferes with the MAP kinase pathway, and you see a clear dependency. And actually, these findings were directly translated into clinical outcomes. You can treat patients with NRAS mutations, with MEK inhibitors, and you can successfully treat patients mutated for BRAF with BRAF inhibitors alone or in combination. And this was a very convincing development. It's hard to find a good example in the whole literature, because we had here two inhibitors, and the study design of these two developments was more or less congruent, and the outcomes were also incredibly congruent. So if you look at the hazard ratio comparison, chemotherapy versus BRAF inhibitor 1, chemotherapy versus BRAF inhibitor 2, you have more or less the same hazard ratios. And also, if you look at the impact on survival here, one combination, overall survival, combination therapy versus monotherapy, 0.7, combination therapy versus monotherapy with another combination, all in the same range, everything very, very consistent. So targeted therapy definitely was a big step forward, but can it really solve everything? So we are still discussing this, when we should use targeted therapy and when we should use immunotherapy. And one finding that I believe is important, and actually I would like to tell you about this because we worked on this for more than 10 years, is the transcriptional plasticity of tumor cells. What do I mean with this? So we talked about the genetics, and the genetics have a nice thing, they are very stable. But unfortunately, tumor cells are incredibly dynamic, so they can adapt their transcriptional and profile and their behavior to the situation. And we think that this is one of the major features of tumor cells. And probably this is due to the fact that they have access to programs that are typically restricted to development. And again, this gives you the link to neural crest stem cells. We believe if we understand the programs of neural crest stem cells, we can understand how melanoma cells can adapt to the different situations. And we have created a model where we say tumor cells have, if they feel good, as you, if you feel good, you eat a lot, you get are stable. If you are in a bad situation, you change your programs and you move. So there are two programs. One program is proliferation, and this is associated with melanocytic transcriptions or melanocytic phenotype, and there's another program, and this is a mesenchymal stemness phenotype, and this is in a constant exchange, and this is also very heterogeneous in a tumor, and we call this phenotype switching hypothesis. And we were really working a lot. This graph is from a paper from 2008. And I very recently found a paper in Nature that was exactly coming to this point from a different standpoint. And this was a group of bioinformatic people. And this paper came from the shape of a tumor. And as if we are all used to X-rays. So if we see a tumor, we think a tumor looks like this. But this is not true. This is not true. So they really went three-dimensional into tumor tissues, and they said that a typical tumor in a human being, at least primary tumors in many metastases, look like this. And how can you explain this shape? The conclusion was that tumor cells are not only proliferating, but they are in a constant exchange between migration and proliferation. And with this, you get this very dynamic bubbles. So at the end, what I want to tell you with this is that we have limitations with any type of non-adaptive therapy. Tumors are extremely clever, and they are extremely flexible. So we need something that really can deal with this, and obviously the immune system can, and this is what Maurice has shown you. And Maurice has shown you a very similar picture, but a different title. This, from this publication, from Immunity, the immune functions or the exchange between immune cells and cancer cells was called the cancer immunity cycle. And I like the term cycle because it has no beginning and no end. And this is really a dynamic system that is constantly readapting to the situation. And we have now the tools to interfere in this cycle at different positions. And, well, we are human beings, so we have problems to deal with a cycle. So we have to define a start. And this start is here, the release of tumor antigens. And Maurice has already told you that it is very important how the condition of this release is structured. So there is always release of antigens, and if this release is ongoing very quietly and smoothly, the immune system will accept this and say, this is nothing to be worried about. But if you create or have this release of tumor antigens in a very dramatic environment with a lot of danger signals, then the immune functions will wake up. So we have to do everything to make the release of antigens more dramatic, and this can be done, for example, by the injection of intralesional viruses. You might have known that for melanoma we have now a registered drug, even in Switzerland, which is called T-VEC. It's a herpes virus that is directly injected into tumor lesions. So we think this is something that will have a lot of immunological implications. The skin or a tumor area is always connected to a lymphatic structure. And at this area, there is always an exchange between dendritic cells and lymphocytes, and we have medications that are directly interfering with the communication of lymphocytes and dendritic cells. And then there is an effector phase, so our lymphocytes come back to the microenvironment of the tumor and are able to kill the tumor cells. And since we have a cycle, there are a lot of interventions. So what was really the breakthrough of immunotherapy? So ipilimumab is the first studies of ipilimumab have been published 2010, and still the There was a lot of skepticism about this, but really the breakthrough was, and this is nice to show this slide because it's in Zurich, this was in November 2013, at the Turnhalle when Georgina Long presented this type of curve, and this curve is not a PFS, so this is a survival curve. So these are, these are patients treated with anti-PD-1 therapy, and this is the survival curve of patients treated with the conventional chemotherapy that we do. And as Georgina is an Australian, she has a way to communicate very directly. She says, this is so big, so a truck can run through. It's really a big, incredible difference. So this was one of the largest differences in overall survival that was seen over the last years. And we keep on going. So we know now that the treatment with anti-PD-1 is much better than our standard of care in the BRAF wild-type population, which was ipilimumab till recently. So anti-PD-1 therapy is better concerning overall survival and progression-free survival and response rate. And then there is another approach in melanoma, which is the combination of an anti-PD-1 antibody and anti-CTLA-4 antibody. And here we see, at least at the PFS level, even a better outcome. So obviously immunotherapy has caused a huge difference for the perspective of patients with metastatic melanoma. And the good news is also this perspective is durable. And this was first time demonstrated for ipilimumab. You see here a follow-up time of 10 years. And you notice that the patients that manage to survive with metastatic melanoma more than 3 years have a very high chance that they will not progress anymore and not die of the disease. And I don't know, this was the question for you, how is this, is there a new equilibrium or was the tumor eliminated? So this would be a very important question for us. So how confident can we be that these patients really will stay alive? And with the new anti-PD-1 antibodies, we don't have such a long follow-up time, but the trend goes in the same direction. And what we talk about, the tail. So we are interested at which percentage we will have this long-term survival. Actually, we believe that this long-term survival will be in the range of 40 to 50%. Now, this means every second patient will live more than 10 years with metastatic melanoma. And this is a complete change. So let's say 5 years ago, you would say 1 out of 20 would live so long. So this is a dramatic impact on the outcome of our patients. And this is definitely also reflected by the new guidelines that are in place. So the standard treatment before 2010, chemotherapy really does not play a role anymore. We have immunotherapy and we have targeted therapy, and the patient should go in one of these in unresectable. So if we have BRAF mutations, we still have the choice. In BRAF wild-type patients, we have no choice. Immunotherapy is the one and only. The interesting thing is, even with targeted therapy, we have long-term survivors in a certain subgroup of patients, and these are patients with a good prognosis, which is characterized by lymph node metastasis, low LDH, advanced age, so elderly patients. So there is a certain clinical profile of patients that can survive long-term. And we have to find out what is better in the future, whether in this patient population and in other patient populations, shall we always start with immunotherapy or do we switch? And when should we switch? So these are clinical questions. So this is the good news, but unfortunately still half of the patients die. So we have to understand why does the immune system not work in these patients, and this is really a very interesting and relevant topic. So you have heard by Alexandra about the interaction of tumor cells, dendritic cells, and T lymphocytes. And we still believe that today the cytotoxic T lymphocytes are key to control the malignancy. And therefore, the recognition of class 1 presented antigens is very crucial, but which are the antigens that are very relevant? So in melanoma, we have melanocytic differentiation antigens. So melanoma cells have genes that are involved in the production of pigment, and there were a lot of vaccinations ongoing with using these antigens, unfortunately not so important. So is this something that is really important for a long time positive outcome of immunotherapy, or there are other antigens, cancer testis antigens, so antigens that are only found in certain tissues in human beings? We don't know, but I think for neoantigens, we can say this is probably very important for the outcome of the patients. Still, we don't know, is it prognostic or is it predictive? This is a very, very important question. I come to this later. And obviously, everything that is involved between here and here, everything that is ongoing in the process that we call antigen processing and antigen presentation is very relevant. And melanoma cells are very clever, so they use mechanisms that are established in the body to protect, and one of the organs that is well protected is, for example, the placenta. So many molecules that are used by the placenta to keep out T-cell responses are also used by cancers, and this includes a number of secreted factors, but also surface molecules, as we heard about PD ligand 1 and PD-1. So you already have heard that this PD ligand 1 seems to be an important molecule, and therefore we have to understand how it is regulated. And one of the interesting things is that probably the T lymphocyte is very important to upregulate PD ligand 1, because gamma interferon can do this, and if you have no T cells, also PD ligand 1 is down in many patients. And this PD ligand 1 can be stained by immunohistochemistry, and I ask you, Rolf or Alexandra, I've asked, is this marker relevant? And for melanoma, I would say typically it's not relevant, except it may be relevant if we have to decide whether a patient has to go on immunotherapy with PD-1, anti-PD-1 monotherapy, versus a combination anti-PD-1 plus anti-CTLA-4. And this is demonstrated by this paper that was published last year in the New England Journal of Medicine. And here you see progression-free survival in two patient populations. Here is the outcome in patients that express PD ligand 1 for nivolumab alone versus a combination in comparison to ipi. And you see here the overall population. So this means that in this subgroup of patients, so patients that have PD ligand 1 expression, there is no difference for the outcome for the combination versus monotherapy. And since you know that more drugs, and this is definitely true for ipilimumab in combination, give more toxicity and also more costs, this can be a very important situation that we really have to consider this marker for the selection of patients in daily clinical practice. But obviously, this is very simple, and I can recommend that you read this paper by Christian Blank about the cancer immunogram, and actually this can be applied to any type of cancer disease. So he defined a number of factors that are relevant for the outcome in immunotherapy, and he recommends that in the future we draw a picture like this for every individual. And based on this picture, we will make our choices and say this patient needs this type of combination. With PD ligand 1 today, probably only the only one. And one of these features here, tumor foreignness, so how is the tumor recognized by immune functions? And foreignness is more or less defined by the mutational load. And today we know that if we look over all cancer types, the mutational load per tumor is very heterogeneous. You see here, for example, lung. Here, there's a wide variation. If you go on the other side, like B-cell lymphoma, this is by far lower. And you are now experts here in the room. You will hear about many cancer types, but you know lung is a good target. Bladder is a good target. Melanoma is a good target. And some of the colorectum, for example, are good targets. And if you see here, all of these tumors have here a proportion of patients with a very high mutational load, and therefore this information, which will result in neoantigens and good targets for T cells, so this information will be something which is important for the future, and we have correlated this in with many other groups here for ipilimumab, for the outcome of ipilimumab. And the key message is, it's not enough to know only the overall mutational load, but you really need to know how many of these antigens fit into the HLA type of the patient, so how many of these new neoantigens will be really presented. And if you have the number of presented neoantigens, then this correlates to the outcome. So this is really very dramatic research that is ongoing, and we are all a little bit confused about this paper. This is a paper in lung cancer where they start to distinguish between clonal neoantigens. This means neoantigens that are present in more or less of all cells versus neoclonals or non-clonal, so neoantigens that are only seen in a minority of the tumor lesions. And this is really a very challenging paper, because here, for example, here you have one patient that has overall a lot of antigens but does not profit from immunotherapy, and they claim that this has neoantigens that are subclonal, and the argument can be that these subclonal neoantigens can somehow inhibit the recognition, the successful recognition of clonal neoantigens. So there's a lot to do, and I think this is really very exciting work. And Tony Ribas and his group has really challenged this and say neoantigens are important, but neoantigens are only prognostic features, and it's more important how DNA repair is going in these tumors, as we have heard for colorectal cancers. So how do we see this in Zurich? Actually, we tried to integrate this information, and for this we have now a molecular tumor board report. And in our tumor board report, we have here information on the mutational burden. So if we do investigations by deep exon sequencing here with Illumina, we also give information how this is. We show the typical mutational spectrum here. These are the typical melanoma genes. And we also look for other mutations that are typically found in other malignancies and are targets here for medications that are available. So we think this type of information will be the future. And this is the reason why we have agreed that we need a molecular tumor board. Once in a while, we have now said once per month, and then these reports will be presented with the case, and we will hopefully learn how we can use this information in the future. And what we can do in dermatology, in addition, we will always have also live tumor cells, and we think that some of the information that we have here can be tested in vitro again in order to see whether these genetic alterations can be also targeted in vitro. And finally, I promised to show a case. And I like this case because it shows how our approach to the patient has changed. You see here an elderly man who suddenly had neurological symptoms. And the patient had the imaging, and he had this huge tumor in the brain, and he had extensive metastasis. And actually, in the UK, this patient would go to palliative care directly. And this was also discussed in this patient. But okay, he was in a good shape. So the radio-oncologist came, did the stereotactic irradiation. And then this patient went on immunotherapy. And you see here this situation where you think, well, this is progressive disease. No, it's not progressive disease. It's ipilimumab or anti-PD-1 induced pneumonitis. So he had pneumonitis, he suffered. But at the end, he had this picture, which is complete clearance for more than a year. Finally, he had a metastasis in the intestine that was removed. And he's still in perfect situation. In addition, he had chronic lymphocytic leukemia that stayed the same. So he's doing fine. And he had this relapse, and again, these relapses are our targets for our research. And another paper just in the New England Journal a few weeks ago talked about this, how acquired resistance can occur. And I just entered this slide because I heard to your presentation, Maurice, about the immunoediting, and here the reason was defects in interferon signaling. And these defects will result in antigen presentation, and therefore the PD-1-induced immune responses will not work any longer. So this is a summary how the situation is today, and you have seen these type of graphs about the synapses between peripheral cells or antigen-presenting cells and T cells, and how complex this is. And if you think that we are only playing on two of these possibilities today, you can imagine how the future will be. And the future is now. So we have a number of new trials ongoing. So consider to send the patients for clinical trials. I think we have a lot of clinical trials. So we have a combination Nivo-Ipi. We have a combination with an IDO1 inhibitor with anti-PD-1. And we will have very soon a combination of anti-LEG3 in combination with anti-PD-1 that will be a joint project. So this treatment will be available for patients with lung cancer, other cancers, and melanoma. And this is a lot of work. And therefore, finally, a picture of our clinical research team, mainly the clinical trial team. And everybody is very enthusiastic about this. But still remember, 50% of the patients die, and this is too much. Thank you for your attention.